Sean Michael Quinn, some Powers John's Lane Irish whiskey for my favourite Irish. Fáilte Arás, welcome back to the bar. Sean Michael Quinn, aka Quinners, you're at the bar. Welcome, Fáilte. And before we get into the chat, because there'll be plenty of chat, we have to pour the whiskey straight away, because it was a birthday with a zero in it on Christmas Eve, if I'm not mistaken. Is that 30?
We won't say which zero, but it's definitely a zero, though.
We won't say which number's in front of it. No, so a belated birthday wish to you. Sláinte.
Sláinte.
So how was it growing up having a birthday on Christmas Eve?
So you never actually celebrate your birthday on Christmas Eve. Okay. I guess that's the thing, is your birthday is different every year. Some people get to celebrate their birthday on August 10th or January 16th every year. I think my birthday is pretty much varied from December, call it 12th, all the way back through maybe December 28th, 29th. Okay. Definitely before the new year, but depending on how the holidays work out, or school schedules, or when you could get a reservation at a different restaurant or whatever. Okay. It changes every year.
And,
so.
And the big question would be, did you get one present or two?
That's, you really...
Depending when you were obviously younger, you probably got two, but as you got older, it was...
Yeah.
You were a cheap Christmas.
Very, very easy Christmas, but something I appreciate is my family has always been very good at making sure that they are two very different days.
Okay.
That, birthday is here, and Christmas is here.
Great. And you brought a gift, and I love when people bring gifts to the bar, but you brought a bottle of Teeling, small batch.
I did. Yeah. I wasn't quite sure what Irish whiskey to bring,
okay,
knowing that you have a pretty extensive collection. And so when I was looking at a bunch of different Irish whiskeys, I immediately gravitated to one that I knew nothing about, hoping that you could actually tell me something about that whiskey. So this is, I saw it and I went, all right, let's have a go.
It's got a shiny container.
I actually, as you know, somebody who has been in the beverage industry, I still fall susceptible to a nice shiny label.
Well, and as I told you before we started recording, you scored major points because firstly, it's a Dublin distillery.
There we are.
And secondly, it's the queen of curls, or the queen of the house. It's Sandina's favourite whiskey. So yeah, you scored big points coming in here. And
outstanding.
And in return, we're drinking your favourite, which is Powers John's Lane, which is another fine drop. So thank you for the gift.
Here we are.
And you are the first winemaker that I've had here at the bar.
Yeah, that's interesting, scary thought, to hear that as number of different guests that you have, that I'm the first one to be in beverage production, but for wine instead.
We've had a couple of chefs.
Okay.
And a few of the neighbours.
Okay.
But first winemaker, and I'm hoping you're going to be the first of many.
Hope so.
Because I know that while you make wine, you also drink plenty of good beer and drink plenty of fine spirits.
For me, beer not so much. I'm a cider man.
Okay.
I switched to cider a number of years ago, and though I do appreciate a good beer, there are some days you just rock up and you're like, no, I need something cold off the draft.
Okay.
And, you know, Guinness doesn't count as beer. Guinness is Guinness. So yeah, there are plenty of days where you just go.
Guinness is its own food group.
It is. It really is. But as far as refreshment goes, I went down a cider bit of a rabbit hole a number of years ago. And there are so many things happening in the cider industry that they're really getting away from the sweet stuff and really showcasing heritage apples and really good dry, using interesting yeasts. So
fantastic.
I've got a few cider cans. Good. Kicking around the back of the fridge more than beer cans.
And I'm going to guess that during harvest, there's the odd cool cider consumed after a long day at the winery.
Odd here and there is a very gentle way of putting it. But I'd say most nights, by the time you get home, it's drams.
Okay.
Here and there. That's what catches. Yeah, the weekdays are for the cider and the weekends are for the whiskey.
That you got it sorted. So originally, we've discovered, we've known each other for years,
yes,
and I. Didn't realize that we actually both came here to Napa Valley the same year.
I was going to say, within a month or two of each other.
2008. Goodness.
It's scary to think that it's been going on 15 years that I've lived here.
Yeah, no, and obviously back in those days, we talked about it again. We connected. It was the big social media frenzy was happening back then. There was a huge amount of new events happened here in Napa Valley. I believe it was probably around the event in St. Helena, Cheer St. Helena, that we probably connected and met. And mm-hmm. And then your journey into winemaking, it's been wonderful to watch it.
It's been an adventure, for sure. You know, to have started in the process at my first winery in Virginia, in Williamsburg, and then to go from there, you know, learn what it was to just, you know, stack barrels, you know, run a filter,
yeah,
and do a punch down or a pump over here and there. Find a bit of a journey to Australia, see another region. I did get to go and visit Germany while I was working in Virginia, and kind of really started understanding the international aspect of it all, because, you know, getting into the wine industry in an area that's not really known for wine, you have to kind of really find your own path, you know, around too many people. And so you're kind of picking up little things and pulling out strands when you find them. And then it just got to the point where I was like, well, if I'm going to do this for serious, I have to be in California. And so just hop on an airplane, fly into Sonoma, get dropped off in the square and go,
welcome to wine country.
Here we are.
Yeah.
But yeah.
And was there anything growing up that got you into wine, got you interested in wine?
So, you know, I'm one of those East Coast families that my parents were very much a Carlo Rossi jug wine for my dad and a blue bottle German sweet Riesling for my mom.
So would that be Blue Nun?
It was never the Blue Nun. Okay. It was always Rheingau, but it was, I could not tell you the brand.
Okay.
To save my life, and I apologize to my mom ahead of time for that. If she ever needs me to go buy one, I'll pick whatever I want. But thankfully, since then, we've had quite a bit of a journey with them and wine as well.
So there was wine at the dinner
table? There was always wine at the dinner table, but I was actually lucky enough to have a pretty large family. My mom is one of six, and my dad is one of five.
Okay.
So there's always going to be somebody within the family to introduce you to something new. And my mom's oldest sister, who happens to be my godmother, her and her husband, my uncle, are very big wine people.
Okay.
And so always for my birthday, we're talking about things around birthday.
Yeah.
I'd get to take the train from where my grandparents' house on Long Island out into Brooklyn, where they are.
Okay.
Because before we were in Virginia, I spent the first half of my life on Long Island in New York. And as I got older, you know, you actually get to have a...
Get exposed.
And one of my first real memories of wine, and it's a story that I've told a couple of people, is we were at a barbecue restaurant in Manhattan called Blue Smoke. There was actually a version of it here in Napa for a minute. But one of the original ones was there in New York, and we're eating spicy ribs, but we're drinking white wine. And I thought that was such an interesting concept. But it was, you needed something to manage the spice, so we had a little bit of fresh acid and sweetness.
Mm-hmm.
You always immediately think meat, red wine, here's how you go. Yeah. But I just remember that sort of combination as being a bit of a, flavors can really be different on how you approach them. And just kind of got a bit of an interest there, and always having wine with them, of course. And then while I was in university in Williamsburg, at college there, got introduced to wine a little bit more through some of the restaurants I worked for, got introduced to the local winemaker, and then it just kind of became stepping stone one after the next to the next.
And a lot of people who would watch this won't realize that there's actually wine made in all 50 states of the Union.
I believe so. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's even some made on an island in southern Alaska.
I was going to say, Alaska was the only one I'd always wonder about, but the rest I can imagine.
Now, not trying to be in any way disrespectful or disparaging, a lot of the wine that's made in some of these states is I'm not sure what the word is. It's difficult to drink. You know, a lot of it's made from in places where the climate is not great. How was it what was the wine styles that you were making and involved in Virginia?
The biggest thing I learned about making wine in Virginia is that we are all always at nature's mercy, but in Virginia, it's a little bit extra because it's right when you're trying to harvest, is hurricane season.
Oh, lovely.
And so if you can't get the fruit off before a hurricane, it can change things really, really quickly. So ideally, you would want something that ripens a little bit sooner, maybe has a little bit looser of a cluster if you can, to have good airflow.
Okay.
Because there's plenty of water throughout the summer, your pressure for different pests and mildews is very different than we experience here in California. So, I mean, you can have any number. We could go down any different strand that you would want for all the different things. But Virginia is the home of American wine. I could be slightly off about this, but I read it on the back of the bottle so many times working for that winery that I'm going to assume it's true. We made a Chardonnay in Williamsburg called the Act 12. And the reason it was called the Act 12 is in Virginia, the first wine law, I believe it's the first one, is the Act 12 of 1619, which stated that all landowners had to have a minimum number of vines on their property to grow for grapes, to make wine, and to eat.
So, Sean, if you're wrong on that, I have no doubt that somebody will...
Somebody on the internet will come back and be like, no, there's an older than 1619. Yeah.
Which is fine, because we weren't planning on going down the history of wine in Virginia.
But there we are.
So, you mentioned Chardonnay. You would have been growing the noble varieties there?
We had a few on the main part of Virginia, but we actually sourced a fair amount of our Chardonnay from the Eastern Shore.
Okay.
Which is that strip of land that isn't connected to Virginia by the mainland, but is actually connected to Maryland and Delaware.
So you've got
to
leave
a state. You've got to go across an 18-mile bridge over the Chesapeake Bay to get to where those grapes are and then bring them all the way back.
Okay.
But there are other spots around the state that had Chardonnay as well. But we had a couple of growers over there on the Eastern Shore that grew some wonderful Chardonnay, and really quite nice.
And one of the interesting things about your journey is you ended up in wine. We'll talk about obviously what you do here in Napa now, but you went to college for theater.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously exposed to wine in your... And I'm not trying to catch you out on anything.
No.
In some ways, I suppose, winemaking to a certain extent is a little bit of theater.
It is. While I was in college doing theater, most of my time spent in production and design.
Okay.
So lots of stage management, lots of lighting, lots of set design, building, construction. And it was one of my favorite parts in the process is that you sit down with a script.
Okay.
And you read the script, and we all, when you read a script, you kind of create the idea in your head. But you're a part of that process because the director then comes to you and says, this is my vision. And in technical theater, your whole idea is to take their vision and to make it a reality. The director is going to conduct everybody, but you have to actually build it.
Yeah.
And so it's always quite fun because you build this whole thing and then you hand it over to somebody else, and then it is theirs to
do
put actors on it and do with what they want. And at any part of theater, what's always appealed to me is the same as wine, is that anybody who can be drinking the same bottle of wine or watching the same stage play can have two very different experiences at exactly the same time. And that's always something I come back to, is that any bottle of wine that you drink, really right here, from the minute we open it till the minute we finish it, has changed.
Mm-hmm.
So any theater run from the first performance through the last performance is going to change. And like I said, two people sitting at the same table or in the same theater will have completely different experiences. And it's those sorts of fun little ideas that make both of them really appealing to me.
Yeah,
for sure.
No, it makes complete sense. It makes complete sense. We talked, you're a rugby fan.
I played rugby while I was at uni.
Yeah, I'm a rugby fan.
And you and I,
we're not the biggest guys.
No, but luckily I'm just broad enough and of the right height that I make an either really good number 11 short winger.
Okay.
Or if I'm good enough, they'll put me in at scrum half once in a while.
Yeah, because you and I were, obviously I never played up front. I was always a winger. I played left wing, so I believe that's number 14. And I played full back. So you and I, we're not big guys.
No, but I really enjoy getting to play as a scrum half because you get to be in the mix and you get to get the most ball touches. and toss them out and kind of control the flow of the game a little bit, as it was, without having to be the biggest guy.
Yeah, number 10 and pull all the strings.
And if you've got the ball at any point and you see a guy much larger than you, chances are there's a forward standing right next to you. Just hand it to him. And he'll go in and have a bit of a mole or a rock, and then you just take it out and move it down the line a bit.
So it's not on the script for what we talked about, but obviously we're 8-9 months out from the next Rugby World Cup in France.
Yeah.
In Bordeaux, wine country. It will be one of the many venues in France. How do you think the States are going to do?
I'm just really happy that, you know, the States have got such a growing, you know, program, and it is showing better year after year after year. And the more that we can sort of televise rugby and really showcase how much fun it is,
yeah,
I think we're just going to get a better program year after year. And
competes, you know, with like so many, because it is a minority sport here, mm-hmm, in America. It competes with, I suppose, the Big Four, maybe even the Big Five if we include soccer in that now.
I would say soccer is definitely one of the Big Five.
Yeah, obviously, you know, we got football or gridiron or NFL, baseball, hockey, and basketball. They're the big ones. They get all the play, all the TV money. But we're here, you know, we're out in California, where rugby is larger than a lot of people would give a credit for. I mean, Berkeley just down the road, and Stanford. Berkeley, I think they win the championship every year here in the States.
Yeah, where I played rugby in college, we were never actually going to be picked up with Berkeley. I just remember hearing, oh, those larger schools, and you're just going, that's a very different speed to the game than we're used to.
And then obviously, you know, a birthday with a zero in it, but mm-hmm, you're still, as they call it here, you're still running out. You still do kind of touch rugby.
There's a social touch squad up in St. Helena that plays on Sundays that I had gotten back into for a minute, but last spring got a little bit overexcited. Managed to score a try.
Congratulations.
Had a great break. Made it through the line, went all the way down to the end, touched the ball down, chuck it off, and ran back to starting position, which, of course, in rugby, you get the ball back when you score, which is quite lovely. And they kick off to us, and we're moving the ball down the line, and I see what I think is going to be a good seam, call for it, and as I go to take off, the Achilles went for me. So I spent the better part of this year in a boot. Luckily, it didn't go completely, so no surgery or anything like that. But definitely spent the majority of this year hobbling around in a knee boot. And
so the lesson there is, because you also had the birthday with the zero into it.
Yep.
You're not as young as you think.
No,
you are.
That definitely, looking down the year at a birthday with a zero in it, and that happens, you kind of go, all right, well, maybe I'm not going to be running as much. But I don't know. There's a couple of gents on the squad who have had both knees done, from what I understand. If they can keep running, maybe if I give it some time and some rehab, I might be out there again myself.
Great, great. Listen, and back to winemaking.
Yeah.
Because I know it's a passion. You spent 4 years out of the valley, out of the Napa Valley in Napa County. You worked at a fun and interesting winery about 45 minutes or so southeast of us here. Worked with some fun grape varieties in an area a lot of people wouldn't know for winemaking and grape growing. But you've told some lovely stories of working with some interesting grape varieties down there at Hannah Nicole in Contra Costa County.
Yeah. We didn't play with too many unique varieties. You know, we had the noble varieties, all five Bordeaux, Cab Sauv, Cab Franc, Malbec Merlot, Petit Verdot. We had some Sauvignon Blanc. But we also had some Grenache, some Petit Syrah, and a little bit of Viognier as well.
Lovely.
So I think I counted all 10. But what's really interesting about Contra Costa is that it's one of the older grape growing regions in California. When pre-prohibition, turn of the century, when San Francisco was a bit more of a hub, especially right up until the Great Earthquake, a lot of Contra Costa was planted.
It was country.
It was lots of grapes up there. And one of the big unique things about that area is the soil out there. It is got sand, real sand. And some of the vines in that sand are original plantings. You know, 100-year-old Mourvèdre, they would call it Mataro in Contra Costa, and Grenache and Zinfandel. And it's just so interesting to kind of walk through that area and see some of those really old vines and how they're still producing
And you've talked about walking in the vineyards. Obviously, you know, every good winemaker should know what's happening in his or her vineyards, and you practice that. You talked about how normally when we, and as you know, we're here right on, you know, actually literally in the edge of Carneros here, and you walk through the vineyards here, and there's kind of a lot of clay in this part of the world.
And we're heading to Colwell's also had quite a bit of clay for that estate vineyard, but it was so interesting because of Mount Diablo and the delta and how that's situated with the weather and the soil there. You'd go just a few miles north of us and that sand would start coming in and you'd go out to the vineyard and you'd sink.
Sand on your boots.
Yeah, whoever thought you'd be in the middle of a vineyard, but you felt like you had a beach.
Yeah.
But it's a great spot for growing vines, and they can be own-rooted because there's no phylloxera in sand like that.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. No, interesting. And then after your stint there, you moved up to Amici Cellars up in Calistoga, north end of the valley here.
Yeah, after a number of years out there, getting to work with their team and understand those 50 acres, I was lucky enough to, you know, be hired on by the Amici squad and be a part of their team and really kind of come back to Napa and see how they're making wine and learn from them. You know, because every step in a winemaker's journey is really just about learning. Yeah. You can be doing this for however many vintages, and every vintage is going to be a new, unique experience. And every vineyard you get to work with is going to teach you something new, and every other team member you can learn from.
Yeah.
And so it was a really cool opportunity for me to have the next step in my journey and learn a whole lot more.
Yeah. Well,
I'm happy to do it.
Yeah. You mentioned journey. That's what it's about. So
I like that technique, by the way.
Yeah.
Well, never.
Everyone tastes differently. It's, it's something I've learned on my journey in whiskey is the two glass trick, as I call it. We'll talk about this for a second. We chatted beforehand.
Yep.
And we were talking about, you know, some of those old Irish kind of, I'm not sure what the word is, stereotypes when it comes to whiskey. So, you know, people would say, well, you don't drink Bushmills because it's a, you know, it's a Protestant whiskey. And an interesting Jameson, obviously a Dublin whiskey, but John Jameson was a Scottish Protestant. But Powers has always been the Dublin whiskey.
We were talking beforehand, and while I was in college and coming out of the theater, I always find theater people not only tend to gravitate towards working in bars, I couldn't possibly wonder why, so you end up gravitating towards meeting other theater people. And one of the bars that I worked at while I was in college was a place called Pints and Pipes, which, you know...
Great name.
Yeah, of course. And there was a young gentleman there named Joey Taylor, who was an actual Irishman, who did a bit of dancing, if you're familiar with Irish dancing at all. And I remember him and I chatting about whiskey one day and talking about where families were from. And he made it very clear to me that if I was a good Irish Catholic boy, then I should only be drinking Powers. So I made sure that if I was ever on premises, it was the only whiskey that was ever in my glass.
Okay.
You know, plenty of family members and plenty of friends would always gravitate towards things like Jameson. I actually do have a small place in my heart for Tullamore Dew.
Okay.
I don't know why, but could be the Buena Vista and a good Irish coffee. Maybe just...
Well, it's when I was growing up, it was Tullamore Dew was always the export whiskey. It was the one that went to America.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if that's true or not, but that was my perception of it growing up. But it's always been, to me, again, perception, the whiskey associated with an Irish coffee. Mm-hmm. And I think that comes from, obviously, was invented on the Shannon Estuary, where Shannon Airport now is, back in the day. But the Buena Vista Cafe is the one that made it famous, you know, just down the road from us in San Francisco. But they, I believe, they use Tullamore Dew in their Irish whiskey, so... Tullamore was never, I grew up in a paddy house, so there was a bottle of paddy, you know, we've got the modern version of it is back here somewhere. People in Ireland talk about, I was raised in a Powers house, or in a Bushmills house, or in a paddy house, or a Tullamore house. But nowadays, obviously, you know, we can see here, and, you know, the selection that's now available, it has definitely changed, But yeah, so the name, we talked at the top, we talked, you know, Sean Michael Quinn.
Oh, yeah.
We had to get the middle name in there because
there's a number of Seans in my family.
Okay.
It just so happens, thankfully, though, we all have different middle names. So it's very easy to clarify. My dad is Sean, me is Sean, and my sister decided to go off and marry a Sean herself. So when it comes to the family, it's Sean Michael, and it's always going to be that. Okay. And then, of course, with friends, as you mentioned, is Quinners. That yeah. just makes that real easy. I actually prefer to be able to use Sean Michael, because if it's just Sean Quinn, chances are your name on the internet can get misconstrued.
And you've had that happen to you?
I seem to have had that happen. A friend of mine a number of years ago, when I was working with the Napa Valley Film Festival, and you get photos taken of you and they end up on Getty Images. Websites will tend to pull those because your name is in the caption. And
without doing their research and
somebody
diligence.
Didn't do their research, but I had a number of people send me an email of a screenshot with my photo listed on the Forbes 500 of richest people in the world, because apparently there's an Irishman named Sean Quinn who was in the number 420 something, and they decided to use my photograph for him on the website. And
you should charge him royalties.
I should have charged him royalties, but from what I hear, he doesn't have much of the money left.
He's been charged with many things in the meantime, unfortunately. Yeah, Sean
but
Quinn.
But definitely, so now I definitely just make sure that I'm Sean Michael.
Isn't that a lovely claim to fame, that you were listed as one of the top 500 richest on the planet?
No. It's only good if you actually
if you have the money. No stash in the Caymans or anything like that?
No, nothing like that.
Okay. So... family, Quinn, yep. Irish name.
Yep.
Where's the ancestry?
Ancestry is from up north. So okay. We're right in the borderlands. And so, yeah.
We've got some northern whiskies here.
We have some northern whiskies here that you and I were talking about a bit early.
Yeah.
Okay, we should pull but this, we should pull but some as questions. You talked about with the stereotypical, being a good Catholic family, we supposedly know Bushmills. So hence the powers came
and,
to be.
And your family, the ancestry, you reckon comes from Derry, Londonderry, Derry County, on the Donegal border there?
That's from what I can understand. Okay. You know, I've got a couple of cousins. My dad's one of five boys, and his youngest brother happened to marry a keen Irish lass, and her sons are doing quite a bit of the ancestry and have okay. been over through her side of the family a bit more and have done some of the research. And as they find out new things... they've been sharing it with the rest of us. But because of the timing and because of when my grandfather's side came over, it's a bit difficult to okay. track some of that down. And then as you and I joked a bit earlier, my grandfather married my grandmother in England. So one of the side jokes are that we are English.
The Sassnachs, as they call them.
We're the English dressed as Irish, but...
it's funny, we as a country, obviously many reasons. There's a long and terrible history of, you know, the British being in Ireland, but so many of us, me included, I left college and I worked in London for years. My kids are born in England. So we actually have more in common with the English, the Welsh and the Scots than we'll ever care to admit, but we love beating them at rugby.
And considering how this Six Nations went, we look like we're doing... not bad, let's hope.
So you'll be rooting for both America and Ireland in the...
I have to. I mean, you good. Know, is it going to be Johnny Sexton's last World Cup? We don't know.
Well, let's hope he makes it all the way through. Because I know he's a marked man.
He's... Yeah.
So
I think he's coming up on a birthday with a zero on it, not too far from now.
Yeah. But. So, no, it's... You know, being raised Irish, you're raised as... we had so many moral victories when I grew up. You know, we should have, but we didn't. We were the better team on the day, and we didn't. And it's been wonderful to see the rugby team do so well over the last number of years. But their holy grail is the World Cup. Mm-hmm. Never made it past the quarterfinals. Always fallen at that hurdle. So,
well, considering how well they played in this last Six Nations, yeah. I think that and is at least the opportunity. As long as everybody stays healthy.
And a great tour to New Zealand and a great autumn series. So yeah, we'll see how it goes. So yeah, you said the family ancestry is from the North Coast. So as well as some Powers John's Lane, I think we should pour a little bit of Bushmills 12, which came to America, was launched in America here back in the spring.
Okay.
And I only picked up a bottle of this a couple of months ago. I have to say, I really like it.
Really?
Yeah. Interesting blend. Interesting mix of barrels on it. They're on the front label there. We can talk about that in a sec. But just come back to the John's Lane. Obviously, as a winemaker, you know, you've got a decent nose, you've got a decent palate. And I know you don't taste Irish whiskey for a living or whiskey for a living. But I just love that. obviously this is single pot still, so you know, the most expensive way to make whiskey, the most laborious, made in batches, triple distilled, 12 years minimum age, and just to me has just got this lovely depth of flavor, as you can see. And you're not the first person on My Favorite Irish to actually have some of this. We've had, you're in esteemed company, so Bob Hurley was here, Chef Bob Hurley, that's his favorite. So he stood at the bar a few weeks back and had the same thing. He loves Powers, has been a fan of Powers. But you made an interesting reference, Sean, before we started recording. You said, that doesn't look like the bottle of Powers
that I grew up with. Yeah, when Joey, at the Pints and the Pipes, handed me my first bottle of Powers, that is not what it looked like.
Yeah.
So yeah, what's going on with this?
Yeah, they redesigned the packaging a couple of years back.
Okay.
2020. I love the old long slender bottle, mm-hmm. And the, you know, we have this is the gold label back here. It's actually called gold label, but it's red. And the old gold label actually had that beautiful gold label. Mm-hmm. I'm guessing they're looking to differentiate it. I think these bottles actually look well on the shelf.
I think they look really good on the shelf.
I know bartenders
stand out, and
bartenders like bottles they can grab and hold and feel. Mm. And I believe that Powers, particularly the gold label, as an entry point whiskey, should be in every bar and every bartender's friend as a base for a decent cocktail.
There you go.
I'm not so sure about that. You know, we got some taller bottles here too. I just think they're, in terms of space, maybe it's a space thing. And as we explained, you know, the top of the bottle is paying homage to the pot still. So they've put some effort into it. But a lot of us old schoolers or old timers, we prefer those long tall bottles.
You just see it and... The thing is, I'd probably walk into a liquor store and be looking for Powers and not be able to find it. But now...
Yeah, what it's famed for is the diamond. It's called the Diamond P. Mm-hmm. So we have the diamond and we have the P in the middle. So that's what they've tried to accentuate in this new bottle. So the what's in the liquid in the bottle is phenomenal.
It's most important, and it's really quite delicious.
And you may not be aware of this, but they're launching a fourth in the range. I've been told it's going to be with us in January.
Ooh.
And when it comes, I will hunt you down here in Napa and we'll have a dram together. It's going to be 100% rye.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, going to have a green label.
So we could imagine.
Yeah, and obviously coming the end of January, it's going to be here in time for St. Patrick's Day to launch. So yeah, we'll as soon as the bottle arrives here, I buy a lot of this from Lawler's. I'll grab a bottle and...
Well, then we'll have to have a quick little 5-minute recap.
Exactly. We'll do a little add-on. So yeah, I'm a big fan of John's Lane. I just think it's a beautiful whiskey. I don't know if you want to try a little drop of water in that before we jump into the Bushmills, just to see, is it... and obviously this is weighing in at 46%. And then the Bushmills tend to be 40%. It's kind of across the board.
Mm-hmm.
But what's fascinating about the 12 is aged in... So Irish whiskey generally aged in ex-bourbon barrels.
Mm-hmm.
As you well know, bourbon just is allowed to be in the barrel once it's first fill. And then it has to... They're not allowed to use the barrels for bourbon anymore. So a lot of that goes to Scotland and Ireland. This is also aged in Oloroso and finished in Marsala casks. So a real journey around the world in terms of the barrels and the casks. 4, 5. Let's see how that is. So, to me, and obviously, like I said, a few people, this is their favourite Irish. Just to me, when you put the few drops in, it just... brings a bit more of that spicy character forward.
It does. What I was really enjoying about this is that there's a rice fruit component to it, and it's one of the things when I was first learning about tasting whiskies is so oftentimes the heat,
yeah.
So oftentimes if you're drinking scotch, the smokiness or different aspects that could come through with barrel aging, with the caramels, but that you can look for fruit in whiskey, and good whiskeys have that almost sort of, in some cases, a bit of a citrus, almost like a peel or a rind or a zest.
Yeah.
Or in other cases, even like a bit of an apricot sort of angle. And when I find that in whiskey, it just really makes me so happy because it shows just an extra layer of depth.
Yeah.
And something, and you don't think of whiskey as being refreshing, but it actually can be like quite refreshing when you have that nice fruit component to it.
Yeah, and there's people making styles in Ireland now, lighter styles. So Obviously, this is pot still, but people doing single malts that are lighter. Mm-hmm. And they're almost summer whiskies. Mm. To your point of refreshing, it's really interesting to see that breath of styles available. So let's put a bit of Bushmills in your glass. And Sean, earliest memories. Was there whiskey in the house? Obviously, you said there was wine.
There's a bit of wine at home, not much. My dad is a big Canadian whiskey fan.
Okay.
I think that has a lot to do with accessibility, and he does like a bit of a sweetness to it. And something, you know, Canadian whiskeys always have that slightly different style on the blend, which gives them a bit of sweetness. And then the Irish whiskeys were for special occasions.
As they should be.
So I think that's kind of where it came down to. It's like, if you're just going to have some whiskey in the glass, or maybe make a cocktail that's whiskey based, you start with the Canadian whiskey, and then if you're going to have a dram by itself, then that's Irish. What the Irish whiskey is for.
Interesting.
So it's an interesting approach. And then, honestly, like we talked about earlier, my real understanding of Irish whiskey and really seeing that was my friend Joey coming in and being like, there you are.
And you mentioned earlier on, Joey, you referenced Irish dancing, but he wasn't just any old Irish dancer.
The rumor has it that, I mean, I watched him when he was performing in Williamsburg with the troupe there, but rumor has it that he was on one of the Riverdance performers.
Okay.
Because
I know there was a number of Riverdance troupes that traveled the planet.
Correct.
Back in the day.
It was quite a bit of traveling. So
okay.
Whether or not he was with Michael or not, I've yet to see video evidence, but okay. I've heard stories.
Okay, well, and take them at face value.
I mean, whoever you say, never let the truth get in the way of a good story. So,
no doubt.
And I will say that
fantastic.
One of my favorite stories with Joey, just because we're drinking whiskey, was him and I, in the Christmas holiday, since we're here now, we ran into each other in LaGuardia Airport, completely offhand. He had been up visiting family in New York, and so had I. Neither of us knew what we were doing, but we managed to just connect in the terminal and found out we were both on the same flight from New York back to Virginia. And so what did we do? We decided to go up to the counter and say, are there any first class tickets left? And they didn't know what they were cut out for, because they said yes. And I said, are they next to each other? And they said yes.
Danger, danger.
And they said, how much? And the worst part was, I said, oh, it's only $50, because it's the moment of, and we want to, if you buy these tickets, we can put more people on the back of the flight.
Exactly.
And we said, and if we get the tickets, we can get on the plane now and start drinking. And they said, yes. And so that's exactly what he and I did. And we got on the plane and we drank as much whiskey as they would serve us.
So LaGuardia to Virginia is...
It's only about an hour worth of flight, but I'm sure we got more than...
A good half an hour before flight and...
Easy.
Okay.
Easy. Luckily, neither of us had a car at the airport. We had a ride arranged to bring us back to Williamsburg from the Newport News Airport. But I can tell you, the person who picked us up definitely gave us one of those sideways glances of, what have you been doing between New York and Virginia? But he was always a good friend for those sorts of adventures.
Very different.
Oh my gosh, very different.
Very different whiskey. Yeah. Deeper. And we can see it. I don't have the white card in front of us. I didn't think we were going to be doing a side by side, but color wise as well, you know. Yeah, interesting. Both 12 year olds.
Okay.
So Bushmills 12. And that means that the youngest whiskey in there is 12. So there could be some older components. It could be, you know, 15, 18 or older.
Okay.
And we know, because it was in the news this week, that Bushmills have got some fabulous stock of old whiskey that they're going to start releasing over the next number of years. So they may blend some of it into this. And obviously same with Powers. It's 12, it says 12 is the age statement, but we'll have older pot still, but very different styles. You know, you've got single pot still, single malt. Bushmills have always been single malt. They use the pot still. And I believe, you know, mix of barrels that we've talked about, it just adds to some really interesting flavors in there. So, yeah, fun.
I like this because you really can get much more vibrancy by pouring it out.
Yeah, because the aromas are still in there.
Mm-hmm. Well, it was, I don't know how, again, never let the truth get in the way of a good story. I don't know how true this is, but when I was first learning about grappa,
okay.
The person who taught me taught me that you pour the grappa in your hand, you rub your hands together, shake them out, and then smell.
And people in whiskey do the same thing.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
It was always interesting to me. It's like, that's how you get the aroma. And I would always wonder, you know, taking the pH of your skin and the oils in your hand, how much of a change that would be. So I really enjoy this technique of getting
and the other thing is you can actually take a decent sniff of it.
Oh, without
burning
losing
the
some
inside.
Nose hairs?
Yeah, and more. So the other good thing about what you talk about, and I don't do it as part of my tasting, you know, the rubbing of the hand, is that you're guaranteed clean hands when you put 40% alcohol in there. So,
so what you're saying is we should have been training everybody to smell and taste whiskey during COVID, because then we would have been really...
Yeah, it's an expensive sanitizer, though, isn't
it? That's true.
Yeah. So listen, obviously you love whiskey.
I do.
And you know, family influences, etc. But you drink it now, and obviously, you know, you drink Powers, but cocktails, are you a cocktail man?
I am a cocktail man. I'm actually looking forward, because after we finish up here, I've got a cocktail plan for this evening.
Of course you do.
My partner's coming in, and we've made a bit of a tradition on weekends through harvest, and we try and keep it up, where we'll order some chicken wings and have a martini. From your neighbors, from what I hear, is restaurant.
They're on the other side of the studio here.
From the kitchen door here.
Yeah. They're not just any chicken wings that Tom makes. They are the world's greatest chicken wings.
They are. They're non-traditional. They're not buffalo. They're teriyaki.
Yeah.
But there's just something really special about them. And now that they're in their new location, they have a full bar and a great bar program. And so I highly recommend going over there and checking that out and grabbing yourself a few wings, and their carpaccio is also something special as well.
It's funny, back in the day when they were in their old location, they used to do a brunch menu, and I would do the carpaccio with a poached egg on it for brunch.
That's a good trick.
And you mentioned their bar program there, and we know, we both know who runs the program there.
Andrew
Salazar does a phenomenal job, highly respected. Your favorite cocktails that he makes for you?
So he gives me a bit of a hard time, because my go-to martini is rather simple. It's just gin and Lillet Blanc. And so he says, oh, so you like a Vesper without the vodka. And
okay.
My idea is, well, yeah, gin tastes good. Why would I want to only have half of my cocktail being
gin? Why would you dilute it?
And then, you know, lots of gin-based things. I'm a huge Negroni fan.
Okay.
You and I were talking a bit about Negronis, and a friend of mine introduced me to swapping out some of the sweet vermouth with a little bit of Amaro to give you that sort of component, which, I mean, we've talking about Irish whiskey and the rabbit hole you can go down here. Amaro
is its own rabbit hole.
It's
probably more like a warren, isn't it? Than a rabbit hole. obviously, we're going to keep on sipping on these.
But of course.
A couple more things to chat about. You love to sail.
I do. I feel like Irishmen are always called to the sea.
How has that been through? You mentioned COVID a moment ago. How was sailing through COVID? Was it?
Well, sadly, so I grew up sailing on the Chesapeake Bay after we moved to Virginia. So I've been from Norfolk all the way up to Baltimore and back, which was really something quite special. And then when I moved to California, actually had two different friends in two different groups both tell me about a boat that they had sailed on. And so I said, oh, cool. I'll come sail with your boat. And then I also told the other guy that I'll catch his boat, because people are always looking for crew. Mm-hmm. And it turned up that very first week I showed up on the boat, it just happened to be that they were both telling me about the same boat. So I knew that was a boat that I was going to be destined to sail on. And so I got to sail on that boat for 10 years. But right before COVID, and the owner was thinking about selling it and moving out of California and up to Oregon. And I think COVID also kind of like sped that up.
Pushed him along.
So sadly enough, I have not done much sailing since COVID. I would love to get back out on the water, because it is really something special. Sailing can be, you know, both very singular, you know, people do solo, but for me it's one of the most unique team efforts in the world, and you can really put a group of people on a piece of wood with a bit of cloth and you can make it go.
I think you're downplaying the technology that exists a little bit. And the thing is, Sean, if you were the Sean Quinn that was in the Forbes top 500, you'd probably have your own fleet of boats.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'd probably, I had the same money he had, I'd probably try and get in the GP or go up against Ariels.
It's not a cheap sport to get involved
in.
But yeah, it can be, you could say the team side of it.
Well, the team side of it, you know, luckily enough, I have enough skill in it that somebody's always willing to have a spot on their boat for me. There's a little plaque on the stairs as you come out up onto the deck that always says, you know, sailing, you know, doing lots of work to move very slowly while getting wet and spending lots of money.
That ticks all the boxes.
I think that's pretty, it was great fun. And the nice thing is with sailing is, you know, by the end, you cross the finish line and you come into port and a bit of a dram is.
Yeah.
Now you can always tell the boat you're on by whether they're a whiskey boat or whether they're a rum boat. Sometimes I feel like you should just have a little bit of everything.
A little bit of both. Yeah. Yeah. No, that makes sense. So you referenced your partner, Whitney.
Yep.
Whitney works up at Jordan Winery.
Jordan Winery. She's also in the industry.
That technically is at Healdsburg?
Up in Healdsburg.
Yeah. It's another beautiful town in this part of the world. And she's actually flirted with a celebrity we talked about. So a number of years back, before you knew her, obviously.
Yes. Well, not only does she appear in a number of the Jordan videos, which have been made famous since she's been with the company, but...
She bakes.
She bakes. And you know what? I'm going to leave it at that because that's a story for her to tell.
Okay.
But yes, she's baker, and she has used her baking technique to make her a little bit famous.
Good.
But the nice part about that is it didn't make her too famous, so I just get to benefit from the quality of that baking on a regular basis. And so I have to be careful. But
yeah.
No, in the sense of...
the winter pounds.
The winter pounds. She having the birthday with a big zero on it, she was really quite lovely and made me an amazing chocolate torte, which has somehow managed to be stretched through the course of the week.
Which is probably a good thing that it's
stretched. It is a good thing. She does it so well that I probably could have sat down and eaten half of it myself, but we've had a slice here and a slice there and a slice there.
And
we'll make it through the entire week. And we'll finish it off, of course. But
New Year's Eve.
I think so. Okay. I think that's the plan.
Fantastic. Fantastic. Listen, and folks who obviously see this will probably have guessed by now we're recording this over the holiday season. We're in between Christmas and New Year's. 2023, obviously, you know, we're in theory coming out of the pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
You've had harvest in 22, which I know is a good harvest here in Napa.
And we're getting lots of rain right now, which I hope we continue to do for the rest of the month.
Yeah. Any travel plans for next year?
Oh, not at the moment.
Okay.
I would like to. Whitney's from Texas.
Okay.
She grew up in Colorado, but a lot of her family's from down in Texas. And I've never been. I've flown through Texas a number of times, but I've never gotten to explore. And she is... twisting the wrist a bit, so
it's time to...
I would love to get down to Texas
see that, and always better, of course, to see it with a local, yeah.
And so that would be really nice. And then I'm always, you know, it would be an absolute dream come true if I somehow managed to make it to France for any of the World Cup. But a large chunk of that is going to be happening right as
wrong time of year.
Yeah, right as we're working in the harvest, so. Yeah. I think I'm going to have to, be really good about just recording games and then going home at night, making sure nobody spoils them, and then watching them before bed.
Because that's the thing that I haven't seen the exact schedule for it, but you know, a 7 o'clock kickoff in Paris, for example, mm-hmm. is 10 o'clock in the morning here. So, and I know there is a group of us over the years who gathered and watched rugby, and we often did it up in Doc Goals, up in St. Helena.
Yep.
In his you know, his man cave, his back cave there, where, you know, 20, 30 of us could hang out. So I guess there will
I'm
be...
I'm sure he's going to be hosting quite a bit, but trying to fit that in around the harvest schedule is going to be something special.
Yeah, yeah. And of course, there's a number of you winemaking rugby lovers in this part of the world. So yeah, it'll be interesting to see how that pans out. But it'll be lovely to see you there for a game or two if you do happen to make it for that. So And we talked about, obviously, the Irish ancestry, but you confessed to me that you've never actually been to the Emerald Isle.
No.
There's parts of Ireland that I haven't been to. There's a number of counties that I haven't been to, and I spent 28 years on the island, so I'm guilty of quite a few things as well.
No, the story though that you heard is that I got close to Ireland once. I was in Scotland for a number of days for my best friend from university's wedding week, and which we drank quite a bit of whiskey over the course of those days, if you can imagine. And we stayed at a place called Glenapp Castle in Ayrshire,
okay,
which is up on a hill, directly looking over the sea to Ireland. And you can see it on a clear day. And there's an actual ferry that runs from Ayrshire to Northern Ireland.
Yeah.
And I made the comment to the soon-to-be bride that if we had too much whiskey during the men's dinner the night before the wedding, that I might chuck him on the ferry the night before and see if he manages to make it back. And she goes, well, whether or not he makes it back from Ireland, you might not make it back from Scotland. And I took that as a pretty good idea.
A stern warning.
We won't be going to Ireland tonight. Yeah. But I drink plenty of whiskey over the course of that. And both Scottish and Irish. And have seen the Emerald Isle and would like to step foot on it one day.
As someone who's descendant from there, you'll always be welcome. And visiting whiskey experiences and distilleries, there's plenty of them there now to see. So when you do make it there, make sure you pack your golf clubs as well. There's the odd good golf course in Ireland to play.
That's what I'm looking forward to. That was the sad trip about Scotland, is I got to stand on St. Andrews.
Excellent.
And got to visit Royal Tenebury, but I didn't hit a single feathery or gutta percha to save my life, and that was quite tough. But all those opportunities are still there. We'd love to do them.
Exactly. Well, we should toast, Sláinte wa, to your health, to everyone else. Thank you for joining me at the bar.
Oh, so happy to be here.
It's great to taste and drink some phenomenal whiskey with you, and great to reconnect.
Oh, so happy to be here.
Yeah.
And this is really, I haven't had this power, so this was a real treat, and to see it along with the Bushmills 12, and to hear your stories about how Bushmills is bringing all these out.
Yeah,
no, I might have to break the stereotypes and
drink some orange whiskey. Fantastic, great, Sláinte. Well done, sir.
Thank you, sir. Okay.